Prathameshwara Ganadeshwara Chintamani. शब्द में दृष्टि सारी सृष्टि सारी समा
काहू के मन की को जाने आकर्षण के केंद्र कृष्ण है,
सुंदरतम रसिकेंद्र कृष्ण है सुंदरतम रसिकेंद्र कृष्ण है
University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He started learning Hindustani classical music from the age of 5 from Srimati Mani Majumdar of Vishnupur Gharana. Suraj has given several performances at Chinmay Mission, the Odisha Society of Americas, as well as many other Indian cultural platforms. He continues to learn classical music from his teacher in addition to promoting Indian cultural arts through performances and competitions. On harmonium, we have Gauri Salem, a ninth grader learning vocal Carnatic music for the past 9 years. On tabla, Shivam Patnaik, an eighth grader learning tabla for over 6 years. He also plays wind and jazz ensemble at his school. We also have on manjira, Vishwas Salem. Thanks again.
Give them a big hand again. What a wonderful performance. Suraj and Shivam, their mother is here. I think, where is she? There she, give her a big hand for spending so much time and making sure they learn the Hindustani music. Thank you, guys. And they are the students of Mani Majumdar. And also, they are also from Chinmaya Mission. We thank them very, very much. This is the combination of all the missions and temples right here under the direction of Swami Ishapananda Ji Maharaj. Swamiji, we are so honored to have you among us today, but also as the president of Vedanta Society, Homer Glen. Thank you. With me, my Co-MC, Raviji is here. Raviji?
Thank you, Amrishji. What a wonderful bhajan. And we have another wonderful presentation today in the series for recognizing and celebrating Sister Nivedita's 150 years.
Birth anniversary.
Birth anniversary.
Before we start the program, I'm going to request our President Stishi to please escort our speakers for today, Swamiji's and Dr. Bhoumik, to the stage. while we are doing this, I want to also say that I've been saying for the past 2 months, this is the fourth of the series of these lectures. We've got two more left, September 27 and October 28. And please come in more tadat, more people come in, because you have no idea what they miss when they are not here. I've been saying all along that Sunirmalananda has done a great job, wonderful job, and this program is done in cooperation with Vedanta Society and Hindu Temples Vivekananda Spiritual Center. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know, the Vivekananda Spiritual Center is under repairs, and other things are going on, but this center would not have been there. Even the concept, even the imagination of that wouldn't have been there, coming to the reality, if it was not for one family, and that is Dr. Vrind and Bala Bisla. We are very honored to have Balaji among us today. Balaji, we thank you. We thank your family for starting this. Really, we are really thankful to you. If you started it, and the movement has, taken, and we are going across. And Swamiji, I introduce you to Balaji, and we are very blessed to have her here today. Thank you.
Speaking of Vivekananda Spiritual Center, I have to let our friends here know that Swami Vivekananda's statue here, the idol here, that was sent to Chicago, was installed in the temple here, thanks to Amrishji. Amrishji immensely contributed for that. We are so grateful.
Well, thank you. That was, as I've been saying all along, that please attend August 26th program. That was yesterday. So why I'm talking about it today? That was Guruji Tapan Bhattacharya's musical program. My God, that was one of the most beautiful functions I ever attended. And if you missed it, anybody missed it, we are gonna have again next year. So keep watching Hindu Temple website that. And just another house cleaning note, I want to make sure that we have all these functions. We have September 27 for Swamiji's, Sister Nivedita's fifth lecture, and most important one is the September 17th also. In addition to that, September 17th is our fundraising dinner. Raviji is our finance chair, and maybe he can speak for 2 seconds for that, on minutes rather.
We have on September 17th an entertainment program, and of course we have a banquet style dinner to do the fundraising for the temple, and we would request your gracious presence and support during that time. And tickets are available.
Now I'm gonna request, since Balaji here for first time, Balaji, I would like you to please come to the stage and present a shawl to Dr. Bhoumik, Runa Bhoumik from University of Illinois, and she's our main speaker instead of our pastor Gabriel, who could not make it. Balaji, thank you. Can I? Yeah, please.
Professor Runa Bhoumik.
Thank you, Balaji. Appreciate that. Bala stays away from all that. She doesn't want no limelight, no publicity, and she's upset at me, but we needed to do this. I haven't seen her for so long. Thank you, Balaji. Now I'm going to request Ravi, I'm sorry, not Ravi. Diva Harsur, it's all in the family. Ravi Harsur, Diva Harsur, Dhananga Sunila Harsur, they're so talented. I will want you to please give the shawl and our token of appreciation to Swamiji. Thank you. And now I'm going to request Mr. Banwar Joshi.
Banwar ji to come and
present a token of appreciation to Swami Ishwaranandan ji Maharaj. Banwar ji is my friend, my guru. I always look up to him. He is the only person who can narrate all shlokas of 18 chapter of shloka of Gita. Thank you, Banwarji. Thank you. Okay, that's good. Not yet, not now. Present.
Ganesh ji ka din tha, to ye acha hua.
Swamiji, people complaining to me that how come Swami Ishwaranandan ji doesn't say anything in all these lectures. So today he's spoken. Thank you. Now I'm going to request Satish ji to welcome our Swamiji's and the audience for this occasion.
As usual, it was an impromptu thing. So it is a great honor for the Hindu temple to be doing this series of programs in honor, as a part of 150th birth anniversary of Sister Nivedita. We have done it for about we got two more to go, September and October. Please mark your calendars. October is the final one with three different Swamiji's speaking. And today we already had the wonderful bhajan, and then we'll have the lecture from Swamiji and the distinguished lady. Dr. Bhoumika's lecture, and I welcome all the speakers, Swami Ishwaranandan, Swami Sarvapriyananda, and Dr. Bhoumika. And please give them a warm welcome.
Thank you, Stishi. We all seem to have low energy today, because they had a 6 hour of board meeting, which was very tough. And so that's why, please excuse us. As I said, our friend Oh, by the way, I must recognize Mr. Mazumdar. He's here. He's the chairperson of our cultural committee. He didn't come here as chairperson of cultural committee. He came here because his daughter is dancing today. So anyway, we welcome you. We have a great program lined up. We have Swami. We, as I said last time, we have gone global. Last month we had Swamiji from Singapore. Okay. Before that we had Swamiji from South Africa. Today we have Swamiji from Netherlands. Okay. Swami Sunirmalananda Ji Maharaj, we are so honored to have you. And I'm gonna start with our program, and I'm gonna request, as I said, it's all in the family. I'm gonna ask Deva Harsur to come and introduce our next speaker of the evening. Now, let me give you a little introduction about Deva. I like to have young people come to the stage rather than we doing it. Very tough to find them. And Deva happened to be here on vacation. She is going back to school next week or two. She's in the 10th grade?
She's going to be a senior.
She's going to be senior, sorry. In high school. She's so dedicated, and I love and admire the parents for that purpose. And admire this young girl. She decided to go out of town. She goes to Phillips Academy, where hardly too many people can get in Massachusetts, near in Andover, Massachusetts. She's going to be a senior, and given the comfort of the house so that she can achieve the goals, what she set with the help of her mother and father for herself. We are really proud of these kids, and I will want you to give a big welcome to this girl who given sacrifice her good life to go and study out of town.
Thank you, Mr. I just wanted to correct one more thing. As you know, Satishji is the president of our temple, and he just finished his 6 hours marathon, the executive committee and board meeting. They're having a stressful time, but they're managing wonderfully well the temple. It's a big institution here. Everybody is a volunteer, and they're managing, and he's at the helm of the affairs right now. And I just wanted to correct the Swamiji's name, who is coming from Netherlands to enlighten us today, is Swami Sunirmalananda, and the speaker of the evening who will give tribute to Sister Nivedita is Professor Runa Bhoumik. Thanks a lot. Now I'll hand it over to Deva.
Hello. Now that Amrishji has given me such a nice introduction, I can introduce Dr. Runa Bhoumik. Dr. Runa Bhoumik is a research professor at the University of Illinois at Chicago. Her work sits at the corner of computer science and neuroscience. She uses mathematical modeling to better understand the brain. Authoring and co-authoring several articles, as well as teaching for many years at DePaul and UIC, Dr. Bhoumik has long given her talents to science and academia. We are lucky that she has chosen to share them with us today, as she gives her tribute to Nivedita. Everyone, please give her a round of applause.
Everybody, and my pranam to respected Swami Ishatmananda Ji Maharaj and Swami Nirmalananda Ji Maharaj. I have never been thought of giving lecture outside of my math and computer classroom, but Swami Ishatmananda Ji is giving me strength, courage, and confidence to perform this task. So this is the third time that I am speaking outside of my classroom. And moreover, Swami Sunirmalananda Ji taught us how to overcome difficulties and fear at Ganges retreat that we attended in last 2 days. So with their blessings and with my limited knowledge, I'm giving a short presentation. I will focus on the impact of Sister Nivedita's life on notable personalities, how she has influenced writers, scientists, freedom fighters, spiritual leaders, and many others. Margaret Elizabeth Noble was a social worker, author, and a teacher. She belonged to a family of Irish freedom fighters. Since her childhood, she learned many valuable lessons like selfless service with love and compassion. Although she was a foreigner, she was the one who dedicated her life to the service of India and Hinduism, among other great women. Margaret met Swami Vivekananda in London for the first time in November 1895. She was charmed by his philosophical discussion and personality. She attended several lectures and question answer classes. And not only that, she also raised questions one after another to resolve her doubts. She realized that this Indian sannyasi would be able to lead her to the truth that she was searching for. She accepted him as guru. At the same time, Vivekananda was convinced that Margaret is truthful, deterministic, and her heart is full of kindness. Vivekananda always wanted to improve the condition of the common mass and women. Education is the only means. Through education, one becomes self-confident and also be able to solve the problems. So he invited Margaret to spread the education. He wrote to her, "What was wanted was not a man, but a woman, a real lioness, to work for Indians, women especially. Your education, sincerity, purity, immense love, determination, and above all, the Celtic blood make you just the woman wanted." After her arrival to India, Sharada Devi, the Holy Mother, accepted Margaret spontaneously as her daughter. She affectionately called her Kuki, means little girl in Bengali. Margaret also realized how simple, pure, and knowledgeable she was, a woman with selfless service and unconditional love. She became very intimate with Sharada Devi. On 13 November 1898, the Holy Mother came to open the school of Nivedita and blessed her. The mother often expressed her feelings towards the sisters. From the Gospel of Holy Mother, we know that she says at last, "The inner soul feels for a sincere devotee." In one of the letters, Sharada Devi wrote to her, "I look at your photo, which is with me every now and then, and it seems as if you are present with me. I long for the day and year when you shall return. I always pray to the Lord that he might help you in your noble efforts and keep you strong and happy." Rabindranath Tagore also had great regard for Sister Nivedita. Tagore had written, "I had felt her great power, but with all that I understood that her path was not for me. She was a versatile genius, and there was another thing in her nature that was her militancy." In his essay, Vagini Nivedita, he adorned her with the title Lokomata, the mother of people, which was later universally accepted and much publicized. Many researchers of Tagore literature later found some similarities between Nivedita and the character of Gora, the longest novel of Tagore. Mr. Davidson, who was a friend and also a journalist, had paid tribute in following wonderful lines. "It is as vain to describe Sister Nivedita in two pages as to reduce fire to a formula and call it knowledge. Like fire and like Shiva, Kali, and other Indian powers of the spirit, she was once destructive and creative, terrible and beneficent." He also mentioned that not only her language, but her whole vital personality often reminded him of fire. Dr. Jagadish Chandra Bose and his wife Abala Bose were among her closest friends. At that time, there was an anti-Bose atmosphere in England among the scientists. Nivedita strongly criticized this tendency. In dependent India, Dr. Bose had to carry on his research with very limited funding. Nivedita knew Bose's worth and came forward to help him whatever way she could. When Bose founded his famous Institute for Research, he got installed the image of a woman stepping forward, lamp in hand, in Nivedita's memory. Not only in the field of scientific research, Nivedita made a unique contribution in developing an art movement. Abanindranath Tagore was one of the artists in that movement, and he visualized her as an ideal of beauty and considered her as meditating Uma. He mentioned that among all the foreigners who loved India, Nivedita occupies the highest position. In 1902, Nivedita addressed a meeting of youth in Madras and gave her inspiring call to them to fight for freedom. The British government immediately blacklisted her. Her action created a discomfort in the Ramakrishna Mission circle. Immediately after the passing of Swami Vivekananda in 1902, she broke the formal relationship with the Ramakrishna Mission, but her interrelationship was never cut off. She undertook a tour of the country to give a shape to her plans. Nivedita met Sri Aurobindo at Varada and convinced him to come to Calcutta and take up the leadership of the nationalists in Bengal. Her school became a haven for patriots, revolutionaries, scientists, artists, and journalists. They all were inspired by her thoughts and actions. If the dry bones are beginning to stir, it is because Sister Nivedita breathed the breath of life into them, said Dr. Rashbihari Ghosh about her influence on the young patriots in India's freedom struggle. Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose mentioned, "I learned to love India by reading Vivekananda, and I came to understand Vivekananda through Nivedita's writings." Professor Binay Kumar Sarkar, an eminent social scientist and intellectual, said that Nivedita was Vivekananda's miraculous discovery for India and grew into one of the profoundest treasurers of the Indian people. On October 13, 1911, at about 7 a.m., Nivedita chanted the Upanishads, "Lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from death to immortality," and breathed her last. Margaret Noble was Irish by birth, but became a true Indian, and her love for India was incomparable. Her contribution towards India is unforgettable, and we should always remember her. Finally, I would like to mention one thing, that we are very fortunate that West Bengal government took initiative on restoration of Sister Nivedita's house in Calcutta. It will establish a museum and archive on Nivedita and conduct research work on Nivedita's contributions. Thank you, and for listening my short presentation.
Thank you so much. Please give a big hand, round of applause to Dr. Bhoumik. Now, before I call on the next speaker, I just want to make sure that we all know that after this program of lectures, we have a great entertainment program lined up for you from Nirtyanjali, and we have two dances today. Those beautiful kids are here already, and with their parents, they came back here at on a popular demand. A lot of the audiences over here, because they were the first one to perform on May 21st function, Swamiji, if you remember. And next lecture is going to be on September 24th. So please bring more friends of yours, and I think September 24th we're going to have a Punjabi dance, Gidda and Bhangra. That'll be another interesting item. And then after that, October 28th, Saturday, right, Swamiji? October 28th, Saturday, will be this last series of the lectures on Sister Nivedita. That there we'll have Hema Rajagopalan's group performing. And that'll be really, really wonderful program. The whole thing is, like you to all, please attend two more months. In the meantime, do not forget September 17. We need that fundraising dinner. Through those dinners, we collect funds for the improvement of the temple and for betterment of the temple. And we will need all your help. Please do come and attend September 17 function. And for information, ask Ravi Harsu, who is the chair of the finance committee. In the meantime, I'm going to request Dr. Sunila Harsu, who needs no introduction. By now you know her. She's a pain specialist, to introduce the next speaker. Thank you.
It's my pleasure to introduce Swami Sunirmalananda ji. So, Swami Sunirmalananda ji is the current head of Netherlands Vedanta Society, a monk of the Ramakrishna Order for more than 25 years. He started his journey in the Ramakrishna Order from Bangalore branch. That's my hometown, so thank you. He had the rare opportunity to serve his guru, the 12th president of Ramakrishna Order, Swami Bhuteshananda ji Maharaj, for 10 years, from whom he later took final vows of sannyasa in 1992. Swami ji has served as an editor of Prabuddha Bharata for 4 years. Later, he became an acharya at the Probationers Training Center. The Probationers Training Center is an institution to train future monks, where scriptures and Ramakrishna Vivekananda literature is taught intensely. Later on, Swami Sunirmalananda ji has served in Brazil, Switzerland, and France. From 2014, he is serving as president of Netherlands Vedanta Society. He has authored books like Insights into Vedanta, an English translation of Tattva Bodha, an introduction for one trying to understand Advaita Vedanta. He has also written Alasinga Perumal, an illustrious disciple of Swami Vivekananda. This is the life sketch of an extraordinary disciple friend of Swami Vivekananda, who played a pivotal role in Swami Vivekananda's visit to the West and his subsequent participation in the World Parliament of Religions. We are lucky to have Swamiji amongst us today. He will be speaking about Sister Nivedita's contribution to Indian women's education. Let's please welcome.
राजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सचित सुख स्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे. I thank the organizers of this great temple for conducting this series of lectures to honor Sister Nivedita. It's a great honor to be here, and I thank Revered Swamiji for inviting me, and to all of you for being present here. Mrs. Bhoumik has already introduced you to Sister Nivedita. A lot of things are going on now in the name of Sister Nivedita in India and in other countries too. Sister Nivedita's importance is being known now as days pass by. An unknown entity in those days, and now she's becoming very famous. In order to know her importance, my subject is education of Sister Nivedita. We must know the situation of India in the past, a little of history. Is it okay? In the Rig Veda, there is a mention of a lady by name Vishphala. She was a queen. This Vishphala was the commander-in-chief of a women's army. That was thousands and thousands of years ago. She goes to wage war against the enemy and loses her limb. Her leg is cut off. According to the Rig Veda, she comes back and she has an artificial limb fixed. And the very next day, imagine, it's not after months, the very next day she goes back, fights, conquers the enemy and brings back bounty. That means there was a time in ancient India when women were great, tremendous capacity, the lioness, as Swami Vivekananda wanted. Indian women were lionesses. That was the power in the ancient times. Slowly, as centuries passed by, and as Indians became invaded once upon another by different cultures, women were to be hidden. And there came a time when women not even had education. They were deprived of everything. They were hidden completely. It was at such a situation, at such a juncture, that Swami Vivekananda heard that Nivedita is going to come to serve Indians, especially Indian women. Mrs. Bhoumik quoted a part of the famous letter that Swami Vivekananda wrote to Nivedita. I wish to quote the letter in its entirety because it's extraordinary. We have not seen such an extraordinary letter written by anybody. Here Swami Vivekananda opens his heart and places before Nivedita all the facts about India in such a brief letter. My dear Miss Noble, a letter from Sturdy reached me yesterday informing me that you are determined to come to India and see things with your own eyes. Let me tell you frankly that I am now convinced that you have a great future in the work of India. What was wanted was not a man, but a woman, a real lioness, to work for the Indians, women especially. India cannot produce as yet great women. She must borrow them from other nations. Your education, sincerity, purity, immense love, determination, and above all, the Celtic blood make you just the woman wanted. This much about Nivedita. He writes in one paragraph who Nivedita was. This is not a letter written only to Nivedita, but to the whole world. He introduces Nivedita to the world. She is such a woman. For Vivekananda to understand a woman, that lady took seconds. He understood this was the person, purity, absolute, determination. So he welcomed her. But yet the difficulties are many. You cannot form any idea of the misery, the superstition, and the slavery that are here in India. You will be in the midst of a mass of half-naked men and women with great ideas of caste and isolation, shunning the white skin through fear or hatred, and hated by them intensely. It was ignorance only on both sides. On the other hand, you will be looked upon by the white as a crank, and every one of your movements will be watched with suspicion. Then the climate is fearfully hot, our winter in most places being like your summer, and in the south it is always blazing. Next. Not one European comfort is to be had in places out of the cities. If in spite of all this you dare venture into the work, you are welcome, 100 times welcome. As for me, I am nobody here as elsewhere. Very frank and sincere. No question of mincing words and telling Nivedita, oh come on, everything will be okay. When you come here, everybody will welcome you and everything. No, this is the fact. Even though Vivekananda knew that Nivedita was desperately needed for Indian work, he knew that. Even in spite of all that, he said, this is the fact about India, and all of us know that that was the fact in those days. Everything he has written is true, absolute truth. Then he says, You must think well before you plunge in. And after work, if you fail in this or get disgusted, on my part, I promise you, I will stand by you unto death. Whether you work for India or not, whether you give up Vedanta or remain in it, the tusks of the elephant come out but never go back. So are the words of a man never retracted. This was the letter written by Swami Vivekananda to Nivedita. Straight forward, absolutely open. And yet, that great lady jumped into the arena. She came. When did she come? 1897. She came in 1897, and immediately she had to plunge into activity. Whatever Swamiji wrote here became true, because as she started working for amongst the plague-ridden people, she used to clean the street and they used to put things there, dust there. That means people used to look upon her with suspicion, etc. But she herself studied the situation and understood some five interesting points. The first of them was, purity and selfishness at the physical level. Purity and, saintliness at physical level. You see, according to Nivedita and the West, the idea in those days was a person would be saintly if everything was clean around him. But the contrary was what was in India, a saintly country, a holy land, everything sometimes was impure, etc. But Nivedita understood that behind this there is some ideal. There is the worship. When they worship, everything is clean, immaculate, pure, excellent. The second thing Nivedita understood was character and expression. In one of his lectures, Swami Vivekananda was saying this: what the world wants is character. The world is in need of those whose life is one burning love. That love will make every word tell like a thunderbolt. Millions of us may speak, but behind that there should be life. Otherwise nobody will listen. Thousands of politicians keep on talking, but who will listen? Because there is no life behind. Vivekananda said this. This made Nivedita think, because according to her, in those days for her, a great orator was a great man. But here she sees something different. The Indian ideal is different here. The person who has a life will utter a few words. Sitting in a little corner in Dakshineshwar, the great saint Sri Ramakrishna would utter a few words, almost inaudible, and they were recorded for posterity, and people are inspired and they become illumined. So the life behind was important. This was something new for Nivedita. The third thing was richness and poverty. That's the usual thing, you see. To be and to have, what is the greater ideal? For the Western ideal in those days, to have was the greater thing, even in India, but on the whole, to be was greater than to have. It's not that you accumulate things which you don't use, that's important. It is what you accumulate as character that was important. All these things were new for Nivedita. It is Nivedita who mentions all this, not me. She says, these are the things that I observed as differences between India and the West. Then, sacrifice for truth. Of course, I could commit a crime and go to hell forever if by that I could really help a human being. This was Swami Vivekananda's statement, her guru's statement. She was stunned to hear it, because nobody would commit a crime in order to help another person. What a great this thing is. And she saw there were people like that. First of all, there was the Buddha. He was ready to give his life for the sake of a little animal, a little bird. He was ready, okay, for me it's nothing. And even imagine Shishupala. We know the story of Shishupala. He was ready to be killed. Why? He was going against God himself, so that if he gets killed, he will attain heaven. Something different. And there was the great Ramanuja. Ramanuja's ideal. His guru tells him, I am giving you this sacred mantra. It is secret. You should not utter before anybody. It should be kept inside you mentally. You must repeat it mentally. But this Ramanuja asks the guru, what will happen if I utter it on the temple, this thing, before others? You will incur great sin. You will go to hell. But others may be liberated. That's great. Ramanuja climbs up the temple and declares the mantra aloud for everyone to hear. guru is pretending to be angry. What is this? The mantra is secret. Why did you announce it so loudly? He says, let people be liberated. I may go to hell, that's no problem. Nivedita saw this and was surprised. Oh, this is the Indian ideal. These Indians will go to any extent to declare themselves, they will go to any extent to suffer so that others might be happy. That made Nivedita think, oh, I am here and my step is correct. What step I have taken is the right step. Then spirituality as the goal. Once Vivekananda was giving a talk in which Nivedita also was present, and he said this: what the world needs now is character. I want 20 men and women who can come out in front of society and dare say, I know nothing but God. Can you do that? He asked the audience. He waited. Then Vivekananda said, fear not. He says, why fear? If this is true, what else would matter? If this is not true, what else would matter? That means, if spirituality is not true, nothing else is worthwhile. If spirituality is true, nothing else is worthwhile. So therefore, spirituality is the only thing. The true life is the spiritual life. How many of you are ready to give your life for spirituality, he asked. That again was surprising for Nivedita. She went on thinking, people live to earn money, to get name and fame, to do great things. But here is Swami who is telling people that they must give up everything and say, I know only God, I live for God. That was surprising for her. Yet she thought, okay, slowly she understood. She thought, and she was no ordinary person. As Mrs. Bhoumik announced, she was a great personality coming from a military family. And not only that, during the course of her contact with Swami Vivekananda, she had attained a lot spiritually. It was no ordinary person, that was a guru. Her guru, by his grace, had awakened her spirituality. She had become an illumined soul. So therefore, she knew what she was thinking about. Finally, when all these were set aright, something else happened. And that was her thinking of contributing towards the education of Indian women, for which Swami Vivekananda came. But what education was it? In 1835, as all of us know, the Indian education system changed forever. Macaulay came to India in 1834. Macaulay's name was Thomas Babington Macaulay. He was born in 1800 and he died in 1859, 59 years. He came to India in 1834 to work in the Supreme Court of India. Within a few months, he gave a report to the British government saying that the language called Sanskrit language is just nothing. The scriptures that they are writing in Sanskrit or they have written are all like nursery rhymes. And then he says, it is, I believe, an exaggeration to say that all the historical information which has been collected from all the books written in Sanskrit language is less valuable than what may be found in the most paltry abridgment used at preparatory schools in England. Oh, they are nothing. Sanskrit language is nothing. Sanskrit books are nothing. Change the system of education. Remove Persian, of course, that was a good thing. And he said, remove Sanskrit system of education. Bring out a new education system. And then the government accepted it. In 1935, the Macaulay system of education was introduced in India. And the next year, the avatar, Sri Ramakrishna, was born 1 year later. And Indians were asked to study the Macaulay system. Why? To become clerks. To become clerks, though that's all. The other-centered life, self-centered life, I'm sorry. So self-centered life, to earn some money and then be slaves. This was the system he introduced. Tremendous change. Everything that was there in the histories like Mahabharata, Ramayana, the great epics which we have been studying since ages, he said are worthless, nursery rhymes. And then Sister Nivedita came in 1897. Swami Vivekananda hit with the same this thing. From the same Europe came a man who said Indian education system in the past was useless, and there comes another woman from the same Europe and says, no, I thought about it thoroughly. And she wrote the cradle tales of Indian history, etc. So many books. She said, no, Indian education system is the best. We may think, what is this education system of Sister Nivedita? Because she did nothing apparently, just a small school in Calcutta. But Calcutta was the heart of India, the capital city of India in those days. So anything done there would hit the whole of the nation. And she conducted a meeting. She called a meeting and then said, you see, I'm going to start a school, send your children, daughters. Nobody was ready. And then Swami Vivekananda came from behind. He went on telling people, please say, I'll send my daughter. Nobody said, no, no, no. At last, Swami Vivekananda forced a gentleman whom he knew, send your daughter to the school. So in this way, a few widow girls accepted. The education system that she started was the ancient Indian system, not only of learning various arts, etc., but also of learning the Sanskrit, this thing, and so many wonderful things. The ideal being spirituality. On the other side, the Macallan system was to make everybody a slave. Here she was to make everybody spiritual and free, absolutely free. That was the important thing. But one thing more happened. Mrs. Bhoumik mentioned that Holy Mother. Holy Mother Sri Sharada Devi came from a conservative family, of Brahmin family, and she was from a village. Let alone Calcutta people who did not want to send their daughters to be educated, this Holy Mother who was from a village came and inaugurated the school, Nivedita school. That was the greatest thing. All of you here today, those from the Indian background, are here virtually because all this happened. Otherwise, no question of women being educated at all. Sit in the room, sit before the oven and go on cooking. That was what was done in the past. And the great women of the past, who were Gargis and Maitreyis, were now just cooking and being happy with that. And then Nivedita changed it. Holy Mother Sharada Devi inaugurated the school. That was a great step, the greatest step. By inaugurating the school, symbolically, Holy Mother inaugurated the education of Indian women. How important is it? Remember what happened in the in Britain. Suffrage, women's suffrage. Up to 1920s, women were not able to vote. They were struggling to vote. Just before that, 20 or 30 years before that, Nivedita had started this education for Indian women. The first batch were educated. People suspiciously saw, did they change? Did they become something different? No, they are the same, they are good. Okay, then I will also send my daughter. In this way today, Nivedita school is flourishing. And not only that, numerous schools, countless schools have come up all over India for educating women. And millions of women are becoming educated. And we have so many professionals, thousands and thousands of them here. This is the importance of Sister Nivedita's education. Nivedita was no ordinary person. Margaret Noble was no ordinary person. She changed the face of India. Mrs. Bhoumik mentioned Jagadish Chandra Bose. That is another important thing to note. Because I have still time, I'll mention this. Apart from this educating Indian women, which was vital to Indian progress, Nivedita did one more thing. She inspired the little hesitant Jagadish Chandra Bose to come forward. It was because of her inspiration that he did so many things, in the sense that she helped him a lot. We may say, who is this Jagadish Chandra Bose? Yes, he was a scientist of the past. It's not so. His importance will be understood slowly as time passes by. Now you are all technical people, highly qualified. You all know about this Internet of Things, etc. What's happening now with this Internet of Things to feed data and get back information was shown by Bose in a university in France as well as in the United Kingdom, that metals also have life, they also weep, they also show sensations, etc. What we call dead inert matter also has feelings. For the first time in the history of the earth, somebody was showing to the world, practically demonstrating that here is a plant, here is a metal piece. Both of them show similar responses when they are instigated. They weave. Everything was shown. So this is something important because these things will be used in the future a lot. And who helped him in this? Sister Nivedita. So Sister Nivedita's education was not just limited to women education alone, but also in the education of the future. And that education was not limited to self-centered, self-glorifying, bread-earning education. As Vivekananda wanted, man-making education. It is not man-making, person-making education. What is person-making education? Individualistic education, in which an individual becomes an individual. That means he can manifest his inner potentiality, his glory. Each one of us has tremendous potentiality. We don't know that. We just keep on wasting our time. But this education of tapping the inner resources to manifest our glory was what Sister Nivedita gave to the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Swamiji, and please give him a big round of applause. And ladies and gentlemen, today we're going to have our Swami Ishakamanda. We are really lucky that he's going to say a few words to us. And may I invite Swami Ishakamanda to please say a few words, both for Sister Nivedita, Hindu Temple, Vivekananda Vedanta Society. Any subject you want to say, thank you.
If I say now, in September, when I am supposed to speak, nobody will be there. So I am reserving. Now, when I was listening to him, Swami Sunirmalananda ji, he was mentioning, quoting from Swami Vivekananda, that Swami ji saw Sister Nivedita a purity. How pure she was, just one incident I like to tell you. Sister Nivedita became known to the society, Indian society. The one gentleman invited her to bless his son and newly married the couple, to bless the couple. Sister Nivedita went with another American lady. See, the moment she went over there, saw the husband and the wife, newly married couple, she couldn't see the human being. She started uttering Shiva Parvati, Shiva Parvati. Sometimes some people, you know, just she is telling like that, but it is not. She was going on repeating, and slowly, sitting over there, she went into trance. When she came back, she was going on repeating Shiva Parvati, Shiva Parvati. Can you imagine the purity? Couldn't see anything but God. And this purity reflected in her life when there was a great plague, a terrible plague in Calcutta. All people were going away from Calcutta. Swami Vivekananda gave a call that you must plunge to serve these people. Poor people. Nivedita was leading the team. She herself was going and cleaning. And one famous doctor, in his name there's a hospital now, R.G. Kar, Dr. R.G. Kar, he noted that Sister Nivedita was nursing a small baby and she was suffering, the girl child was suffering. Nivedita used to go and take care of her every day, and day after day. Dr. Archika told her, you should not come here. This place is not that way clean. You yourself will be affected with the plague. She never cared. And not only that, she was there to take the care of the child for 3 days and nights. But one day they saw, though she was trying hard, but the child died on her lap. And she was going on crying as if her own child has passed away. So that was the way Sister Nivedita used to serve. Service to man is service to God. That was also we have seen in the life of Sister Nivedita. I should thank again and again, and wherever I go, I tell the Hindu temple authority, Lemont Hindu temple, they have given an opportunity to bring the Swamis and the other educated ladies to give a talk on Sister Nivedita. 6 months we are continuing. And thereby, slowly, a small group of people, they are coming to know about Sister Nivedita more intently. If you read books about her and the books that she has written about India, the wonderful way, that we will understand how she dedicated herself for India. So we must remember that gracious lady, and when she was leaving the London, her birthplace, and her whole family, mother and sisters and brothers, she never turned back. And she used to tell, I am going to the land of my dream. Thank you very much.
I want to thank the panel today, Swami Sunirmalananda, Swami Sunirmalananda, Dr. Bhoumik, and Sishya President, and all of you for coming here. And the program for the rest of the evening is I'm going to have Satishji escort the dignitaries to the chairs in the front so that we can clean up this place, and we want to have two dance items by the archery. And please make sure you stay here, give them encouragement, because they're young kids again and learning the and I do want to again begin. After that, we're going to go to Rama's kitchen and have dinner together. Swami is with us. But please remember September 17th date. That's very important in the temple and the dinner. Whatever donations come from there, they help us upkeep the temple and run the temple. These temples run from your donation. Whether it's a Hindu temple over in Chicago or Vivekananda Vedanta Society. So we need your donations for the places. And having said that, September 24th is the fifth lecture of the series right here at our auditorium. And then last one would be October 28th, Saturday. And that will be another big one. And that will be the last of the series. If there are any questions for the Hindu temple dinner, please ask our financial lawyers. And please be patient till you clean the place. Thank you. Others, and I'm looking for
ready.
please give a It's not mic. You're gonna be introducing?
Yeah.
Okay. Please give a big round of applause to this great audience, great dancers. And also my great thanks to Nritya Academy. They do such a wonderful job. The teacher, Sushmita Kumaran, couldn't make it today because I think she had classes. But her husband is going to introduce the artist. Then as they introduce the artist, and once all the artists are introduced, I'm going to request our Swamis and Dr. Bhoumika to please come in front so we can take a picture with these young artists. Here is Mr. Kumaran. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. Nrityanjali School of Dance thanks the Hindu Temple of Greater Chicago and the Vivekananda Vedanta Society of Chicago for providing us this opportunity to perform before you all today. I just want to take a minute to announce the names of the children who performed today. The first item was Shankara Sri Girinatha Prabhu. It's a composition in Ragam Hamsanandi by Maharaja Swati Tirunal. This was performed by Sharon Eliakul. Shannon Eliako, Kavya Vedarmudi, and Aditi Arun Kumar. The second item was the Ganesha Pancharatnam in Ragamalika, and this was actually composed by Sri Adi Shankaracharya. This was performed by Nitya Kapadia, Niyati Kapadia, Ananya Nathgowda, Sumedha Sundaram. Where is Sumedha? Okay. Sunanda Sundaram, her sister. Ahana Narayanan. Vidya Venkatachalam. And Nivedita Rajendran. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, and give him a big hand. And may I request Swamiji and Dr. Bhoumika, please, to come here so that we can take a picture as a sign of blessing from the Swamis. And I want you to know that these students, they come, they spend their time. I want to compliment the parents. Give a big hand, a round of applause to the parents. Somebody come right in the middle, please. Right in the middle, one by one, and we take a picture. And they charge us nothing. They spend time, tomorrow they may have to go to school. So I really appreciate the dedication with which they come. And Mother Sudhanji, you are included. Thank you for coming today. Really appreciate that. While this is going on, I want to thank, please, I can't hear the claps, please give them a big applause. Yes. I want to thank the Hindu Temple, the Executive Committee, starting with Stishi, and especially the treasurer who wrote checks for us today. We got to go home and when she was not feeling well, Shildarji. And I want to thank Sunila Arsur, Ravi Arsur, Divya, Diva Arsur for participating today. Most importantly, I want to thank these artists. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. I want to thank Suraj and Shivam, if they are still here. Thank you. I want to thank Prabhakar Ji for doing such a wonderful job. Now, all of you, the artists, their parents, and the audience, please join us in the Rama Kitchen for Prashad with Swamiji. Thank you, and we